Good morning. My name is Bill Richards. I'm the presiding officer for this session, Icons in Surgery 2, where we honor two great icons in surgery. I have on the stage with me Steve Schweitzberg and Barry Nabnett, both moderators for our session today. We're on a very tight schedule, so after the videos are shown, I'll invite people to come up to the microphones where you'll be video recorded to give comments. Please state your name, where you're from, very clearly into the microphones so they can be recorded for prosperity. Without further ado, we really want to make this all about our icons in surgery. The first icon is Kathryn Anderson, and Dr. Phil Guzzetta is going to be the moderator for this video.
Thank you very much. This is a very happy occasion, and we're here to honor two amazing people. Unfortunately, I was just given some sad news that Jay Grossfeldt passed away last night. And so I'd like to ask for just a few moments of silence before we start this session. Thank you. I was asked to introduce Dr. Anderson's video. I first of all want to give appropriate credit to both Jim Stein and Ed Doolin, who actually did all the work, although I'm the one up here introducing this. Dr. Anderson and I worked together for 13 years. The first 2 years I was a fellow, and the next 11 years we were partners together in Washington. And that's how I got to know Kathy. I'm not going to give you a lot of information because a lot of this is in the video already, but she's been a special person to me in many ways. So can we start the video, please?
Well, I was born in Manchester, England, one of the suburbs, on the day that Hitler marched into Czechoslovakia. And the war, World War II, started 6 months later. And so my earliest childhood memories were of the black curtains that we put up around the house, and the bombs dropping on Manchester, and the fires that followed. Those were my earliest memories. And they included a makeshift bomb shelter that we had in the middle of the house, because the nearest bomb shelter was quite a long walk for what were then basically two babies, two toddlers, my older sister and myself. And so that was in a pantry in the middle of the house. And I can remember the end of the war. Actually, before the end of the war, I remember my aunt saying, and I must have been about three at the time, when Winston Churchill had just been made Prime Minister, "We'll be all right now." And that really brings me to one of the most influential people in my life, my father's sister, who we just called Auntie. And she was a very cultured woman. She was a teacher. And after the war, I was six when the war ended, and this was probably when I was seven, maybe eight. My aunt took my sister and myself to the newly opened Manchester Art Gallery. And I don't remember any of the pictures except one. And that was a picture that was a drawing, probably a charcoal drawing with a green wash, done by Barbara Hepworth. Barbara Hepworth was actually a sculptress, and a very good one, a very famous one. But she did this drawing, and it was just labeled theatre, which is the English word for operating room. And there were about three males in the picture and one female, who was obviously the nurse. And apparently, I was told later on, I just stood staring at it. And I remember that it influenced me. I had a male teacher who, for some reason, was in a class where it was a sewing class, and I was sewing. And he said to me, "Kathryn Duncan," that was my name before it became Anderson, "you would be very good in domestic science as a career." And I think I just glared at him. In those days, one couldn't, I had, my parents had no money, so I couldn't just pay to go to medical school. I had to get a scholarship. And so I spent the next year in high school, applied to Oxford and Cambridge, and got into Cambridge, and met there a woman physician named Dorothy Hurd. We had two sets of tutors. One was a director of studies who was in charge of all the studies that we did. And then we had tutors in anatomy and the basic parts of medical school. And Dorothy Hurd was a widow with two children. And she tried to tell me that I may not be able to be a surgeon because I was the wrong gender. And she said, "You may find yourself doing something that you didn't set out to do." And I just determined that I was going to do what I had set out to do. I developed my interest in pediatric surgery really from an interest in children. We never had any children of our own. And I knew I wanted to do surgery, but I just found that the combination of pediatric patients and surgery was the most fascinating. During medical school, I was shy. Everybody laughs when I tell them that, but I was. And the dean of students called me one day and he said, "I've heard you want to be a surgeon. Well, you're too shy and you can't apply for a surgical internship." He said, "In fact, I will block it." And so I understood that I couldn't go. I couldn't get past this man. So I applied for a pediatric internship and spent a year in pediatrics at Boston Children's, which was an absolutely wonderful year. And if I'd had any doubts at all about pediatric surgery, they were waved away by that year. It was an absolutely marvelous year. But he was very influential in my life. Hardy Hendren was a hero. He was everybody's hero and continued to be beyond his own retirement. I was looking for a pediatric surgical training program that would take me. And the only one, my husband was at NIH. We had no plans to move from Washington, the Washington area. And I needed a residency at Washington, D.C. Children's Hospital, which was headed by Judson Randolph. And that is, Judson Randolph was another hero of mine. He was a young faculty member at the Boston Children's Hospital when I was a medical student. And we would have a pediatric surgery lecture on a Friday afternoon where most medical students were asleep, and Judd Randolph could keep us all awake. So I wanted to train with Judd Randolph, but he really didn't want to train me until he had a gap in his program. There was nothing formal like we have now, where there's a match and you go around on interviews. I would walk up to Children's Hospital from Georgetown, where I did my surgical residency, and I would ask him if he would train me. And he eventually said yes.
My name is Dr. Larry Hill, J. Lawrence Hill in a more formal style. And I was approached about talking and discussing Kathryn Anderson, with whom I worked actually as a trainee to begin with. And that's interesting how it came about. I was in Vietnam commanding a surgical unit, And as it turned out, rather than just being there 10 months, as most surgeons were, they couldn't get I was commanding a surgical unit, and they couldn't get anyone to take my place. So I was there for over a year. Dr. Randolph was in Washington, was one of the first pediatric surgeons in the Middle Atlantic area, in fact. And he had been introduced to Kathryn Anderson, who had expressed a desire to train in pediatric surgery. But he had several of us already lined up to train for the next few years when I had called and told him that I was going to be delayed in Vietnam. And so he called Dr. Anderson up and offered the job to her in my absence. And that worked out very well. When I went back to Washington to do my training in ped surgery, Dr. Anderson was already selected to be on the faculty there, and I got to meet her. And indeed, she was a very charming, very bright, very positive, diligent, had a great sense of humor. She was a wonderful comrade to train under. I can't say anything more positive when talking about Dr. Anderson, because she was just superb and a wonderful comrade, a wonderful colleague in surgery.
I developed a particular interest in during my pediatric surgery fellowship in esophageal surgery. At the time, we had a lot of children who were drinking lye. It was just after a law that had mandated childproof caps on lye, bottles of lye. And most companies were not paying any attention to that law. And a lot of parents, unfortunately, would put toxic substances into Coke bottles. And children don't sip and taste something, they just swallow it down. So we had a lot of children with lye burns to the esophagus. And Judd Randolph taught me how to replace the esophagus when it was necessary with a piece of the colon. And I didn't like that organ in place of the esophagus. So I got interested in replacing it with a reverse gastric tube. And that became my thing, became the thing I was known for, became the procedure that I love to do, and I tried to advance as the surgical science advanced, and I did not stay on at Children's. I went back to Georgetown to do pediatric surgery there. And contrary to my expectations, I was not welcome there, because the chief of surgery at the time, who had trained me in general surgery, excellent Mayo Clinic trained surgeon, but a real curmudgeon, he said, all you need are small sutures. And I just was not happy there. He was no longer the chief when I went back. Charles Huffnagel was, the very famous cardiac surgeon, real pioneer. But he did not let me do any thoracic procedures. And I was trained in that as a pediatric surgeon. So after 2 years, an opportunity arose in Children's, just up the road, and I went back and stayed there until I moved to Los Angeles. Well, as a fellow, I was taught by, besides Judd Randolph, I was taught by three superb pediatric surgeons. John Lilly, who pioneered the operation of biliotresia in this country. Peter Altman, who is the complete pediatric surgeon, and Bill Tunnell. And Peter and I were probably the best team that I encountered as a surgical resident, both in general and in pediatric surgery. And he was just a superb pediatric surgeon. And we didn't ever talk during surgery. We knew what the other one was doing and going to do. And it was just wonderful.
Another special relationship that Dr. Anderson developed was she knew that a good operation was never good enough, particularly in the neonates. She wanted it to be perfect, and we never left the operating room unless the operation was absolutely perfect in her opinion. She and I developed a very special relationship in that when we got to a point where we were dealing with a difficult situation or a difficult case, we would come to the same conclusion about what the next step was. It got to the point where frequently Dr. Anderson could finish my sentences before I finished them, and I could do the same with her. So Dr. Anderson has meant a great deal to me as a mentor and a friend, and I'm delighted that she's been selected for this video on Icons of Surgery.
Well, I wanted to be a surgeon-in-chief to begin with, and I thought that Los Angeles training program was a sleeper program. I was very interested in teaching, and much more interested in teaching somebody how to do surgery than doing it myself, as a matter of fact. And I saw a lot of opportunities in Los Angeles to develop what was a good clinical program with enormous volume and breadth of cases into one of the best training programs in the country. That was my major ambition coming to Los Angeles.
Kathy Anderson provided skilled support both in and out of the OR to so many young surgeons. And I think that is in many ways her legacy. She was probably one of the finest teachers there is, and I know it was her most important contribution and legacy. On arriving in Los Angeles, Kathy came into an environment which was both an academic environment as well as a private practice environment. And I know it was very important to her to really maintain that and actually develop the relationships between all those people to make sure that we had the strongest training program possible. And this is something that she carried on into her presidencies of both APSA and the American College of Surgeons.
I became involved with the societies in both pediatric and adult surgery. I was very interested in the college, and I was very interested in the American Academy of Pediatrics in the surgical section. I can't remember the year that I became chair of the surgical section, but I was secretary first. So that was part of my career that was developed later rather than sooner. I became chair, and then I had the opportunity to replace Dr. Hendren as a governor to the American College of Surgeons. So I basically had two parallel tracks, general surgery and pediatric surgery. And I became a member of APSA, American Pediatric Surgical Association, and became secretary, I think, I can't remember the year now. I'm getting more senior moments these days. I was secretary of APSA for a full term. I was a governor of the American College of Surgeons, and when I was finishing my governorship at the American College of Surgeons, I was invited to be the secretary of the American College of Surgeons. And so I was that for 9 years. I never really particularly wanted to make a mark in the surgical world one way or another. Basically, I wanted to do what I wanted to do, which had been characteristic of my entire life. But I found myself being the first something, the first woman something, the first secretary of the surgical section in the American Academy of Pediatrics, the first chair of the surgical section, the first female secretary of APSA, first female president of APSA. I was certainly not the first governor of the college. Women had been governors of the American College of Surgeons for a long, long time. But I was the first pediatric surgeon to do that, first woman pediatric surgeon, certainly the first woman secretary, and then later the first woman president of the American College of Surgeons. It wasn't something that I didn't set my sights. As a surgical resident, I set my sights on getting through each rotation. And I'm not really a person to go over past things that happened, but there was a lot of prejudice in the early days against surgery, surgical women. There still is, but a lot of those barriers have been broken. I found myself breaking those barriers without really meaning to, just in doing what I wanted to do with my life. So I guess I was a trailblazer. But it's accumulation. When you talk to a true athlete, a true trailblazer, a true leader, they say, it wasn't just me, it was the team. And I feel that very, very strongly. The care of children has improved tremendously by the development and now the maturity of pediatric surgery as a specialty. I'm sure that the pediatricians had the same fight when they tried to break away from the general practitioners. I would say to people, do what you want to do, but try not to do it all at once. Start with baby steps and go to the next. And then, because you'll change on the way and you might take deviations. But do the next step and then the next step and do what you feel happy doing, what you feel comfortable doing. Did I leave anything unfulfilled? No, I don't think I did. What I wanted to do was be a good surgeon, be a good teacher, and have people regret when I retired. And I wanted to retire before people said, well, you have to help the old girl out in the operating room. And so I retired when I felt like I was possibly be at my best. And that was the right time. So no, I don't have any regrets.
Thank you for that rousing applause. I think I have said so many times, I'm an accidental pioneer. Never planned it, just happened. And I'm so grateful. I'm particularly grateful for my mentors, particularly Dr. Hendren, and I don't want to take his thunder. I can't imagine a better honor than being on the same podium with Hardy Hendren. Can you hear me, Hardy? So I'd be glad to answer any questions that you have. Bill, keep me to time so we don't go into Hardy's time. And I will stay afterwards if there's anybody else who wants to come up and ask me questions.
So more than a question and answer, we have done in the other sessions, if you have remembrances and stories or if you just want to come up and say, thank you for those people whose lives were touched or you trained with her. This is really more of a a tribute than a Q&A. So please don't be shy. Yesterday we couldn't get anybody to come up to the stage for the first 30 seconds, and then certainly in the middle and on the sides.
Well, let me start out by saying that I had the opportunity to work with Ed Doolin and Phil Gazzetta and Dr. Stein in the production of this video, and what really came out was, you know, looking at all the raw footage and the storyline was two things to me. Number one, you were told no, you could not be a surgeon by many people in your life, starting in grade school, through college, through medical school, after that, and still you're an inspirational model for so many people that overcame that, you know, no answer. And secondly, your passion for patient care, that comes through in talking to all these people that trained underneath you and worked with you. What's your secret for patient care, and how do you connect with the patients?
Well, first of all, let me make just a silly comment about your first thing, about people saying, no, you can't do it. I quote Nancy Reagan, just say no, I'm going to do it. As far as patient care, my father was absolutely wonderful with children. And he was talking to a child one day, and I said, no, what's your secret, Dad? And he said, follow the child's lead. So when I walked into a room to see a new patient, didn't matter what the age was, I focused on the child. I ignored the parents. And I went and I talked to the child. I remember this little girl, Kathleen. She was a lovely little girl. She was about 14. And I said hello to her, and she started to talk to me. It was absolutely unintelligible. I didn't know what she was saying. She was babbling. She just couldn't talk. But she was talking. So I answered her back. And then she talked back to me, and we had a long conversation. Well, you know, when you get that kind of response from home with a child, the parents just come right along behind. Carlos Pellegrini just talked about trust. How can you mistrust somebody who your kid obviously likes and you obviously like your child?
Hi, I'm Barbara Bass, and I'm just going to say thank you once again, as I know many millions of times, to Kathy Anderson. But I'm also going to tell the story of how I came to meet her, which I hope will be something that you all might think of as you think about people that are looking for their space in our profession, our wonderful profession. I was a medical student at the University of Virginia. And at that time, this many 35, 40 years ago, there were no women residents and certainly no women faculty, but there were two wonderful surgeons there who, once I discovered I was going to be a surgeon, said, well, you need to meet at least a couple of women, you know? And I said, that would be really nice because I don't know what they look like. And they said, well, there's two you must meet. And I've told this story before, but the first was Kathy Anderson's name. The other was Olga Jonasson. The two people that said that to me were Dr. Tony Shaw, who's a pediatric surgeon, and Dr. Les Rudolph, who at the time was a pioneer in transplantation and didn't quite know what to do with me, but said, you need to meet Dr. Anderson. So I went to Washington, D.C. for the day, and I met Dr. Kathy Anderson, who walked me around and I sort of shadowed her for a day or two. And she was the first woman surgeon I ever met. And I think of all the possible first women surgeons you could have met, and I got Kathy Anderson. But it was just wonderful. And she became not only an early mentor, but eventually a dear friend. I was inspired to become a pediatric surgeon by her example. And only when I had my first son during my residency years and got so I can't see a baby with an IV without breaking up that I realized I couldn't do that anymore. But I would be exactly like Kathy Anderson if I could have managed to survive that emotional gap. But thank you, Kathy. You've been an inspiration to millions of us that are here. I mean, it's just astonishing. So thank you.
Thank you, Barbara.
My name is Kurt Newman. I'm a pediatric surgeon. I trained here at Children's National with
Excuse
Kathy.
Me, can we turn the lights up? Go ahead.
And if you could tell us where you're from.
I'm from Washington, D.C. I'm the CEO of the Children's Hospital now here, where I worked with Kathy for many years. I was going to comment on two things that I think are important to young surgeons and more surgeons in general that I learned from Kathy. One is just the critical importance, and Phil mentioned this, of a great operation, a great technical result. I've never seen or worked with a better technical surgeon than Kathy Anderson. I always thought a part of it was her small hands. Can you hold up your hands?
They didn't make my size of gloves until I was chief resident in general surgery. And I stuck with the Perry Company my whole life because they first made them for me.
Size five?
Five and a half.
So the fellows were always frustrated when we couldn't get into those little crevices or holes that Kathy could make it look simple. And her patients always did so much better because of that, just the excellence of her technique. I think the second thing was the importance of that I observed as a fellow was the importance of the team and how she treated the team. And I think it's no surprise that two people are here today. One is the surgical technician nurse that she worked with, Louise Wilson, who's here.
Stand up, Louise.
Who's here in the front row. That would. That's still, helping surgeons at Children's National get out of trouble. She knows the operations better than probably most surgeons. But that teamwork that she, that Kathy had, that would embrace folks like Louise. And then the second is Carol Manning, who's also in the front row. Carol. Was Kathy's long-time assistant and really a chief of staff and helps me in that role now. And Kathy brought that team together. If you walked into the neonatal intensive care unit, you would see that the nurses would instantly gravitate to Kathy, that she knew how to build that team concept, to promote people, their careers. And it wasn't just about the professional side of it, but it was very quietly the personal side of it. Help people out of trouble, help guide them to things. So she's just the complete leader, the complete person. And I think all of us that worked with her were just totally privileged and honored to be with her. Thank you.
Thank you, Kurt.
Pat Newman, a general surgeon from Syracuse, New York. When I first started to come to meetings, there were no women. And there was slowly but steadily an occasional woman appeared, and Kathryn was one of them. And particularly at some of the more elite surgical organizations, the American Surgical Association at that time had no women members, then finally one and then a couple. And to show you sort of the advocate that Kathryn is and how she really not only was the first woman many things, but she also opened the door for so many, was she and Olga Jonasson started a little group that they invited me to. And we would meet at every American Surgical Association meeting, and Olga would come up with a list of what she called worthy women. And Kathryn and Olga and I would discuss them, and then Kathryn and Olga would go to their chairs and ask them if they would nominate them for the American Surgical Association. And they all said yes, and it was sort of the attitude that Kathryn had that, well, they're not ill-intentioned men, they're just not aware. And rather than blame them for something, we'll invite them to participate. And I think that's why she's always been so successful and been the first woman in many positions.
Thank you, Patty.
Richard Lynn from Palm Beach, Florida. I'll be very brief. Like you, my very first rotation as a surgical intern with Bill Simon was at Boston Children's, and it too was also for me incredible, and probably if I had to do all over again, I too would be a pediatric surgeon. But be that as it may, I rise just to say, besides congratulations, that the American College of Surgeons is something that all of us, I'm preaching to the choir, but through it, you get to meet incredible people. And although I knew of Dr. Anderson from all the years and recertification and what have you, I got to know Dr. Anderson, who I'm proud to say I can now call Kathy, my wife and I, and we've become very close. And it has nothing to do with surgery, and it has nothing to do with technique. It has to do with the kind of person she is and her sensitivity and her compassion, and it's just a privilege, and it's a privilege to be here.
Thank you, Richard.
Dr. Anderson, just to let you know that your teaching goes beyond the U.S. I'm from Brazil to Brazil, and I have done over 200 of those reverse gastric tubes, and I learned quite a bit from you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Wow.
It's my privilege to introduce the next honoree and the presenter of the video. Being a Boston person, one of my good friends is David Ratner, and David planted the idea in my head that we should honor Hardy Hendren. And as I thought about it, I can't think of a greater iconic figure than Dr. Hendren, and want to express extreme gratitude to Don Nakayama, who's going to present the video and initiate the presentation, for taking on the challenge of putting together just a terrific tribute to this great icon in surgery. So Don, thank you.
Thank you. I think we should just go straight to the video. This is, I just want to say in just my opening, this is one of the nice things I got to do. So let's see the video.
W. Hardy Hendren invented new operations to correct congenital urological malformations. In a career spanning more than six decades, he transformed the lives of children who would have died of renal failure, live in diapers, or with a stoma. Instead, they lead normal lives, have children, and raise families. He trained a generation of leaders in pediatric surgery at the Massachusetts General Hospital and the Children's Hospital in Boston. Born in New Orleans and raised in Kansas City, Hardy knew as a child he wanted to be a surgeon. Friends of his family who were surgeons took the boy to the hospital to watch surgical operations. He was in high school in Virginia when America entered World War II. After only one semester at Dartmouth, he enlisted in the Navy as an air cadet and earned his aviator's wings. Back in Kansas City after the war, Hardy courted Eleanor McKenna. On their first date, he made the most important decision of his life.
And as I was driving her home, I remember driving up to the corner of West 58th Street, where my mother and father lived, and Ward Parkway. And I stopped and I said, "You're the girl I'm going to marry." And what do you suppose she did? She laughed. And I said, "You wait and see."
They eloped 3 months later. He went to Dartmouth and spent the first 2 years of medical school there before completing his degree in medicine at Harvard. At Harvard, a rotation with Robert E. Gross, chief of surgery at the Children's Hospital, inspired him to go into pediatric surgery.
And pediatric surgery dealt with such a variety of different things that it just beckoned you to come and see something of this. And so I was very fortunate and had a month with Dr. Gross, and that pretty much decided that that's what I wanted to do.
He trained in surgery at the Massachusetts General Hospital under Edwin Churchill, including 2 years at the Children's Hospital under Dr. Gross. After completing his residency at the MGH, Dr. Gross called Hardy and offered him a job back at the Children's Hospital.
I decided to do that, but I told him I did not want to skip his chief residency, that I would do that first. And he said, well, you've already done a chief residency with Dr. Churchill. I said, I know, but I'd like to have the chief residency here at the Children's. And he said, okay, you can do that. So that's what I did.
As Hardy's career developed, his relationship with Dr. Gross became troubled.
His secretary said that you better be careful. You did more cases last month than Dr. Gross did. And I said, well, for heaven's sakes, don't call that to his attention. And her answer to that was, he knows exactly how many cases everybody does every month. I had two cases, and I came in to operate. My name was crossed off the board with a red chalk. And I asked, the chief of anesthesia, Bob Smith, asked me why I canceled my cases and didn't tell him. I said, Bob, I don't know what you're talking about. And the head nurse came out and said, Dr. Gross canceled those cases. And so I went around to see Dr. Gross. And I stood there fully for 5 minutes before he even acknowledged my being in the room with him. And I asked him, what is this all about? And he said, you're doing too much. I said, Dr. Gross, I've been away on vacation for several days to Kansas City. How could I be doing too much? He said, you're doing too much. And I would suggest you go down the street and find an office someplace, and we'll see how things work out. So I went to see Dr. Churchill that day. Dr. Churchill said, Hardy, Bob will never let a good young man come up underneath him. It's just not in the cards. And so I want you to come here to the MGH and start pediatric surgery here, see what you can do. And so that's what I did. I moved out of the Children's that day and went to the MGH.
Once he was at the MGH, Hardy was immediately busy, taking call every day. He saw children with urological problems, an interest he developed from his years at the Children's Hospital.
And I would go through all these records, some of which were like this, with various and sundry things, ilia loops, and so forth. And the more I got into this, the more I would see could be done differently.
He recalls his first case of mega ureter.
I did some half-baked thing, and it didn't work. And so I put in a temporary tube, sent him off to Florida, and meanwhile moved myself away from Children's and back to the MGH. And what I did was took down the whole distal ureter, trimmed it, reimplanted it so it wouldn't reflux, and it did beautifully. Before long, I had enough to write a paper on the subject. And so I put it on to the AUA as a paper to be given in Florida at the AUA meeting. And Jim Glenn, who was then the chairman of urology at Duke, made a comment. He was very suspicious that I was a charlatan and that I was not presenting before and after of the same patient.
Dr. Hendren's operations were adopted first in England and France before they became accepted practice in the U.S. He never shrank from difficult surgery. He operated on more than 200 cases of cloaca malformations, some operations lasting 24 hours. His stamina and perseverance in the operating room earned him the nickname Hardly Human.
I never tackle something just because it's there. I tackle something if it's sensible to do. And frequently, it's a redo case that somebody else has done in a half-baked fashion. And if I think it can be done better, I just do it.
Dr. Hendren remembers some difficult operations with Dr. Gross.
But he would have times that he would be over his head. And at a time like that, he would sometimes give up and walk away and tell you to close. And so you can't do that in surgery. You can't abandon a patient because the patient is presenting you with some very difficult task to do. And I never felt belittled by the Hardly Human nickname. That never bothered me, because what really was important was that you do a good job of the operation and that you never walk away from the patient knowing that you have not done it well. And what you have to do in those circumstances is eat some crow and do it again.
Harvard surgeon Joseph Ficanti trained with Dr. Hendren's service as a resident at the MGH and was his first chief resident at the Children's Hospital.
But I guess I came to learn of his technical abilities directly in the operating room. And his own scrub nurse, Dorothy Enos, and he worked seamlessly no matter the complexity of any patient in any situation. In fact, I came to look at it as almost silent ballet or poetry in motion. They were so fluid in their movements. After that experience, I decided that he would be the surgeon that I would most try to model as I learned the craft of surgery.
Well established at the MGH, late one evening, Hardy received a phone call. The voice was very familiar, but one that he had not heard for years.
And about 10:30 one night, the telephone rang. Hello, Hardy, this is Dr. Bob Gross. I thought I was having a nightmare. I got out of the bed, and the elder said, what are you doing standing up? In the middle of the night, I'm standing up, and she's wondering, what is he doing, going bonkers? And the voice went on, I'm getting the Bigelow Medal next week. And I would appreciate it if I could have you come with me and do my slides for me. And I said, well, I'd be happy to. Go to John Allen and get a new projector. Have an extra extension cord with you. Have an extra bulb with you in case a bulb gets blown. And pick me up at my office at 4:00 in the afternoon, Wednesday, whatever it was. People started coming in at about 6:00. And when they saw me standing there with Robert Gross, they couldn't understand what it was all about. Kenny Welch walked up and he said to me, here's a $100 bill, and I'll give you this if you'll drop his slides.
A final reconciliation came a few years later at the American Surgical Association meeting where Hardy had a paper. Dr. Gross, who was there at the meeting, told Hardy that he would like to discuss his paper at the meeting.
Dr. Gross made some very nice remarks about the paper and what a great feeling it was to be at the end of a surgical career and see your young people gaining ahead of where you were at one time. And I am reminded of the words of Leonardo da Vinci. I'm sitting there not knowing what was about to come. A good teacher will be outshined by a brilliant student. And at the moment he gave that, the entire American surgical rose. I've never seen that happen before or since. Well, Francis Moore is the person that walked up behind me in the egress from the auditorium. And he said, Hardy, you may have thought that Bob was discussing your paper, but that's not what he was doing. He was giving you a public apology for what he did to you years ago.
I think his spirit of innovation, in spite of the heavy criticism from the conventional world of opinion leaders, his determination to make things better for children that were afflicted with terrible diseases, some of which would ultimately prove fatal. So his reconstructive approach was really a paradigm shift, and it required an enormous amount of focus and determination in spite of criticism. In summary, I would say that it has been a privilege to be associated with Dr. Hendren. It has also been very rewarding to see that he is now recognized for all of the innovations that he either brought to the world of surgery and children himself, or that he sponsored so that others could innovate under his tutelage and direction.
Hardy's one of those surgeons like, just everyone knows him as Hardy, like Cher or Beyonce. So it's all just Hardy, and just that there's a Hardy, there's an Eleanor as well. I think we have to recognize Eleanor as well. There was a special patient that was on the video toward the end. Can you explain who the video was, who the patient was, and how she's special?
That girl had just given birth to a baby at the Brigham Hospital, and she herself had a cloaca when she was little, and she had three other children at a later time after that. And that made me feel very good to have her in such good shape.
There was another anecdote about your relationship with Dr. Glenn, the surgeon from Duke who critiqued your mega ureter paper.
Well, Jim Glenn was a professor at Duke, and I happened to know that his sister was the wife of a resident in orthopedics at the MGH, and she did not notify Jim of her being there and having a baby.
Car crash. And
she said I didn't want my brother to come because I knew he would want to get right in the middle of everything, and I didn't want him to do that. And then I said to him, Jim, I think that we should shake hands right now and start all over again. And that's exactly what happened. He became a good friend of mine, and when he moved to New York, he invited me down as a visiting professor. And so, if you hold your tongue sometimes, it pays off eventually.
Any comments here? So if people want to share their thoughts and comments, if you'd please come up to the microphone, state your name, and tell us where you're from.
I'm Margaret Nicholson. I'm applying for the surgery residency this year. And as a pre-med, I shadowed John Mulliken, the director of the Craniofacial Center at Children's Hospital. And so I knew of Dr. Hendren through him. And last night I wrote to him and told him who I'd just met. And he described Dr. Hendren as a master surgeon and said, I learned more technical moves from him than from other teachers. So I thought I'd pass that along.
Thank you.
Marshall Schwartz. I'm a pediatric surgeon in Philadelphia. And I had the privilege of training at Boston Children's in the mid-70s, both as a general surgery resident for a year and then back as the fellow. And at that time, Hardy was at the Mass General. And I had heard the story about Dr. Gross and the cases being crossed off the board. And I thought it was, what an unfortunate thing for those of us training at Boston Children's that we did not have the pleasure of being exposed to Dr. Hendren. So towards the end of my fellowship, I decided I was going to go over and watch Dr. Hendren operate at the Mass General. And he was going to do one of his tour de force undiversions on a child that had 14 or 15 or 16 prior operations. And you can imagine what that ordeal might be like. And apropos to what Dr. Hendren mentioned about the commitment to stick with the patient to the end. So I made arrangements to go over there in the morning. I had contacted Dr. Hendren to ask him if I could come and watch. And he, of course, said yes. And I got there, and the case started, and it's going, and it's going, and of course, with all the adhesions. And I was going to be on call that night at the Children's Hospital, and it's getting close to 5 o'clock, 6 o'clock, and it's still going on. And I said, Dr. Hendren, I'm really sorry, but I'm going to have to leave to go back to be on call. And I know that that operation went well into the evening, and the commitment that he had to that case and the technical ability to get through that case was incredible to me. And Dr. Hendren was already an icon in the mid-70s when I was in Boston Children's. And I was just in awe of the commitment that he showed in seeing to the end that patient, who I understood afterward did quite well. One other anecdote I want to give you, and that was, I think it was 1981. By the way, Dr. Hendren has an incredible memory. And I was sitting next to him at an AMSA meeting, and he had been offered the opportunity to come back to Boston Children's Hospital. And he turns to me, and we're just sitting at the meeting, and he says, Marshall, do you think I should take that position? I don't know if you remember this, Hardy. And I'm thinking, why in the world is he asking me? I mean, I was a junior faculty member elsewhere. But my answer was, of course, Dr. Hendren, that's where you belong. And that's where Dr. Hendren did belong. And one final comment, and this is for those of you who might have this opportunity. My wife and I had the honor of visiting Hardy and Eleanor two summers ago at their home in Duxbury. And in Hardy's basement is a well-cataloged log of every single patient that he has ever taken care of. And he knows all of them by memory, what operations were done. And many of these patients continue to contact him 20, 30, even 40 years, and maybe even longer afterward. An incredible tribute to you, Hardy, as a real surgeon.
Dr. Shahabuddin from Pakistan, Aga Khan University Hospital. And we were honored by a visit by Dr. Hardy about 20 years back when I was his intern. And we had an experience of going for boating and crabbing. And he taught a lesson of a very important lesson about ensuring safety and small or very attention to minute detail or small attention to small signs and symptoms, which have a very detrimental influence on the quality of life and the prolongation of the survival. And as I progressed in my training, I realized that these two messages were very important and how patient can be improved. I feel very honored and privileged to be part of this grand gathering where a tribute is being paid to such a great hero in surgery. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Margaret Hendren. I am from outside of Boston originally, and I happen to be the granddaughter of Dr. Hendren as well as a patient of one of his. So I just have a funny story to share. So I know Dr. Hendren as Papu. Papu performed a surgery, a bilateral urethral implantation, excuse me, re-implantation on me when I was 4. And Dorothy at the time, who's one of our great family friends and also a nurse, came into the room and said, "Now, Margaret, this is going to go very well. Your grandfather is going to take great care of you." And I looked at her and I said, "I just know this is going to be a disaster." And it wasn't. And I'm still here. And so I don't think I've ever articulated a thank you to him. So I wanted to take this chance to do that.
My name is Alfred Chaheen. I'm a pediatric surgeon here in Washington. I've never worked with Dr. Hendren, but in the 90s when I was interviewing for pediatric surgery, I did not match my first year. And about a week after the match, I get this handwritten letter from Dr. Hendren encouraging me not to quit because I did not match and telling me that it was worth proceeding on and applying again. And in huge part because of that letter, I applied again and I'm a pediatric surgeon now. So thank you so much.
Before we close, let me say that that damn airplane that you saw me in made me deaf. And so I'm having trouble understanding all the comments that people are making, and that's why I'm being so quiet up here.
I'm Steve Stylianos. I'm from pediatric surgeon from New York and a former trainee of Dr. Hendren's, and it's probably a good thing that he can't hear me. It's probably flashing back to but we heard in the video that Dr. Hendren has never abandoned a patient. I also want to acknowledge that he's never abandoned a trainee. And he's always had the pick of the litter, but every once in a while there'd be a runt in the mix. And he always made sure that we were okay, that things were going well. Not only that, but he asked us about our family, our spouse, our children, and has continued to do so for the decades since I left him at Boston Children's. So, Dr. Hendren, it's an amazing privilege to be one of your and Eleanor's professional sons. Thank you and congratulations.
I would like to thank two people. First is Dr. Nakayama for putting this together. Thank you so much. And most important, is the lady right there. Would you please stand up, Eleanor? She was very brave and accepted my proposal almost 80 years ago. Thank you.